Blackstone presents Bhendi Bazaar by Vish Dhamija. This book is read by Deepti Gupta. This book is dedicated to Zoe. Who's Zoe, you might wonder? But Zoe knows who she is. So I'll say it again. This book is dedicated to Zoe. Bhendi Bazaar is one of the several infamous red-light areas in Mumbai. It is right behind Crawford Market, where the top brass of the Mumbai police are headquartered. Neither the name nor the location is incidental, though. Story is that Crawford Market was one of the prized wholesale markets built by the British. The British called the area south of Crawford Market behind the bazaar. The Indians picked up the British lilt as Bhendi Bazaar. Mumbai. It was once Bombay, till 1995. Hawala, hooch, hafta, and hookers are some of the infringements that infest Mumbai. To assume that the hoi polloi or the high-heeled don't know about it would be naive. The police, sometimes, even know the who and where. But they have bigger criminals to catch. Most Mumbai citizens don't think it's their business to interfere, to stop, or to report. They have their own pains and miseries. They have no desire to be involved. Who has the time anyway? Mumbai gives you a lot, but sucks the life out of you in bargain. The traffic, the population, the drudgery. Despite the battles they know they would have to fight daily to survive, approximately 450 new people come to this distending megalopolis daily to make it their home. That's a city like Brussels added every year. They come because they know this is the only city in India that will provide them with, if nothing else, two meals a day. 1. 1982. New Delhi, India. The non-aligned movement, of which India was a founding member, was an attempt to impede the Cold War. But all it could accomplish was to hold back the members from overtly siding with either of the dueling superpowers, the Soviet Union and the United States. Soviet Union's love for India and vice versa, however, wasn't exactly a clandestine affair. It wasn't pure circumstance that India was the first international customer for MiG-29s. It was to counterbalance neighboring Pakistan's purchase of F-16s from the U.S., the two non-aligned states. With the U.S. boycotting the Moscow Olympics in 1980, even the optimists hadn't expected the Soviets to participate in the 1984 Games at Los Angeles. To exhibit their solidarity with sport, the USSR allowed, under controlled conditions, those involved with sports to travel to New Delhi as spectators for the 1982 Asian Games. The Kremlin had decreed that the various sporting bodies would be responsible for taking a limited number of athletes abroad and carting them back the day after the Games concluded. No tourism. So while visas for Soviet nationals to the capitalist bloc were excruciatingly difficult, if not impossible, to obtain a visa to a non-aligned, but nevertheless friendly, state became comparatively straightforward, particularly under this pretext. In any event, why would any compos mentis individual leave a socialist paradise to live in the third world? The closing ceremony of the Games over, everyone, athletes and the spectators, retreated to their hotels. It was the Soviet camp's last night in New Delhi, and it was time for all 157 of them to return to the red the following morning by the scheduled Aeroflot flight from Palam Airport. It was, for most, time to pack up and return to the rusting life behind the Iron Curtain. Not for Magdalena, Dunya, and Varinka. They had plans. They had made plans long before leaving Moscow. More than a year before the Games, to be precise, when the trio had been told about the opportunity. The only uncertainty, and the girls' worst fear, was if their government decided to pull out at the last minute, crumbling under some unforeseen pressure, or if the political environment worsened due to their nation's ongoing military presence in Afghanistan. But it didn't, and the three friends progressed with their plans. They didn't picture themselves living their entire lives in a communist country, dreaming of independence, capitalism, the lifestyle. Intelligent enough to understand, there wasn't an escape in ordinary circumstances, which Western European state would grant a visa to teenage girls. They hatched plans to flee, for good, on their return from New Delhi. Magdalena, 17, and the oldest of the three, was the originator of the idea. It didn't take her much effort to convince the other two.
Can we? How? Are you sure? Will it be risky? What if we are caught? Will we be jailed? Where will we go? What shall we do?
The team, together, gathered answers to many other such questions. Sadly, a few questions were still unanswered when they boarded the flight to Delhi. The United States was ruled out as the final immigration destination. It would be too risky, explained Magdalena. Their security was airtight, and young girls of Russian origin would ring alarm bells. She vaguely remembered her mum telling her stories about one of her aunts who had escaped to England after the war, and the idea had stuck in her young mind.
England, we'll go to England, she had told the other two excitedly.
The entranced 16-year-olds were raring to believe anything that would take them away from the drudgery of the mundane, bourgeois life confined by the shackles of communism to an alluring Western life like an endless rainbow. Some lunatics fantasized about a detente between East and West, but it wasn't going to happen anytime soon. If one wanted a free life, one had to flee. Of course, there were risks, but they would be well worth it. Magdalena had kept the detailed plan under wraps from the other two till she was confident they wouldn't renege on taking off, and then demanded rigorous secrecy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.